إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها فكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعله عوجا الحمد لله رب العالمين All praises due to Allah who has blessed us with Islam who has guided us to this path we would not have been able to guide ourselves had not Allah guided us All praise is due to Allah, the Lord of all the worlds. Alhamdulillah, Allah Subhanahu wa Taala has blessed us to be on the verge of Ramadan. And we pray that Allah blesses all of us here to attain to Ramadan and to gain an abundant share of the blessings to be found therein. Ramadan, or the fast of Ramadan, as we all know, is one of our great, is one of the pinnacles of our devotional life. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one hadith, has described many of the virtues and benefits of Ramadan. So we will base this address, inshallah ta'ala, on that hadith. The hadith is the following عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كل عبد ابن آدم له الحسنات بعشر أمثالها إلى سبعين أضعاف إلى أضعاف كثيرة قال الله عز وجل إلا الصيام فإنه لي وأنا أجزي به إنه ترك شهوته وطعامه وشرابه من أجلي للصائم فرحتان فرحة عند فطره وفرحة عند لقاء ربه ولخلوف فهم الصائم أطيب عند الله من ريح المسك So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is related by Abi Hurayrah رضي الله عنه as saying all of the actions of the child of Adam are for him or her, and good deeds are multiplied 10 times over, 7 times, 700 times over, many times over and beyond that. And Allah says, so the hadith shifts, one of the rare hadiths that starts as hadith nabawi, qala Rasulullah, and then it shifts to hadith qudsi, qala Allah. And so Allah says, Be he mighty and majestic, except fasting that is mine, I will reward the servant with that. Verily he has left off his carnal appetites, his food, his drink for my sake. The fasting person will have two delights. A delight when he breaks his fast, or she, and a delight when he meets his Lord. And the foul odor that sometimes emerges from the mouth of the fasting person is sweeter with Allah than the fragrance of musk. illallah. Rawah al-Bukhari wa Muslim. This hadith is related by Imam Bukhari and Muslim muttafaqun alayh. Therefore, it is agreed upon. So there are many, many points, and there's very little time. So we'll make as many salient points as we can, and then we'll have to leave it at that. The first point is that all of our deeds, with the exception of fasting, are multiplied 10 times over, 700 times over, and in another narration, إِلَىٰ عَضْعَفٍ كَثِيرًا, many times over and beyond that. So 70,000, 7 million, 7 billion, عَضْعَفٍ كَثِيرًا. But there's some numerical limit in terms of their reward. This reminds us, in light of the fact that any misdeed we do is one against us, وَسَيِّئَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. The sayyah is one against the person, the good deed is immediately 10, or 700, or 7,000, or 70,000, or 700,000, or 7 million, etc. إِلَىٰ عَضْعَفٍ كَثِيرًا. Brothers and sisters, you have to work hard to go to hell. Right? If one sayyah is one and the good deed is 10, 700, 7,000. Then how hard does a person have to work to end up in hell? This shows the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of the enemies of Allah, they say, oh, Islam, Allah is a stern, unforgiving, ruthless God. No, we say, you don't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This caricature that you've constructed in your head, which immediately says, that's not Allah. Why? لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like unto him. So whatever image you've conjured up in your head of this tyrant sitting up on a throne in the sky, or whatever image you have of this cruel, ruthless caricature, is not Allah. كُلُّ مَا خَطَرَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ فَاللَّهُ بِخِلَافِ ذَلِكَ. Anything that you might imagine, Allah is in opposition to that. And so this image of this cruel tyrant, Allah is in opposition to that. Allah is merciful beyond mercy. He's merciful beyond any human descriptions, conceptualizations, imaginings of mercy. He's beyond that in terms of his mercy. And a manifestation of his mercy is Ramadan. A manifestation of his mercy is this month where the gates of his mercy have been flung open. And one of the manifestations of that is the multiplying of the deeds. But the fasting itself is exempted from that. قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ إِلَّا الصِّيَامَ. So the mustafna is fasting. And what is exempted from? مُسْتَفْنَى مِنْهُ تَضْعِيفُ الْعَامَلِ. The multiplying of the deeds or the reward for the deeds. So fasting, therefore, has no numerical limits. And the ulama, they say one of the reasons for that is that fasting involves patience. Fasting involves patience. Unlike the prayer, we're going to pray Jummah in a little while. It's going to be 5 minutes, it's over. Fajr, even a lengthy recitation of Surah Baqarah, a good portion. But 10 minutes, 15, max, it's over. Fasting is all day. And it's not just all day for one day, it's all day for 29 or 30 days. So it takes a lot of patience. Patience has three basic types. As-sabru ala ta'atillah, patience in dealing with the difficulty that comes in obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالصَّبْرُ عَلَى مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمَحَارِمِ. And patience in dealing with the difficulty that comes in avoiding those things that Allah has made forbidden. وَالصَّبْرُ عِنَ الْمُصِيبَاتِ. And patience in the face of calamities. They're the three basic types of patience. Ramadan involves all three types. So we obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we get up earlier than normal so we can take the suhoor, the pre-dawn meal. And that involves difficulty because we don't have enough time to go back to sleep. And so we're at work and we're fighting sleep. This is part of the difficulty that we have to endure and patiently endure in Ramadan. There's patience in avoiding those things, the difficulty that comes in avoiding those things that Allah enjoins us to avoid. And in Ramadan, they're the good and pure things. Normally we can drink water, and we appreciate it. Normally we can drink juice, and we can appreciate it. Normally we can drink milk, preferably organic, from an organic grass-fed free-range cow. And we appreciate it. We appreciate it. We can eat our food. We can eat succulent food. Beef, or lamb, or goat, or vegetables, and wholesome breads. In Ramadan, we cannot eat what's lawful. To say nothing of the unlawful. And this is part of the secret of Ramadan. This is for one of the keys to taqwa. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامِ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مَنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O you believers, fasting has been ordained for you, as it was ordained for those who preceded you, in order that you will increase in your consciousness, your awareness of Allah, an awareness that translates into implementing His orders and avoiding those things He has prohibited. So if we're avoiding for 29 or 30 days, for the entirety of a long, late spring day, things that Allah has made lawful for us, just for the sake of Allah. إِنَّهُ تَرَكَ شَهْوَتَهُ وَطَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ مِنْ أَجْلِ. Just for the sake of Allah. Not because they're bad for us. Alcohol is bad for us. It destroys our brain cells. It leads to cirrhosis of the liver. It impairs our judgment. It, for those who might be prone to violent outbursts, it pushes them towards violence. It contributes to most of our automobile fatalities. It's the major factor in most of our domestic violence. Alcohol is bad. But the things we mentioned, juice and milk and water and lawful things we can drink, are good for us and beneficial. If we can avoid them, only because Allah Ta'ala has commanded us to avoid them, how much easier does it become to avoid those unlawful things that are bad for us? And so this is part of the taqwa training of Ramadan. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. This is part of that training. And so we avoid our food and we avoid our drink in Ramadan, during the days of Ramadan. And it brings hardship, especially these long summer days. Maybe some of us will get headaches because we're not drinking. Some of us will have stomach cramps because we're not eating. Most of us will feel fatigued and a little bit drained at the end of the day because we're not eating or drinking. So that's part of the hardship that comes in avoiding those things Allah has prohibited. So Ramadan has that element. And the pain of the musibah, the calamities, that physical pain, we experience that in Ramadan. So Ramadan combined by these elements, hence, it's been referred to as the month of patience, Shahr al-Sabr. And what is the reward for patience? Allah Ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. The fasting people will be given their reward with no numerical reckoning. So in that fasting embodies patience. And patience has no numerical limits in terms of its reward. Then it's only fitting that fasting should have no numerical limits in terms of its reward. Hence Allah Ta'ala is saying, إِلَّا الصِّيَامَ فَإِنُّهُ لِي. Fasting is not limited to those numerical limits. That's mine. I will reward the servant for that. Then he says he's left off his food, his carnal lust, his food and drinks for my sake. إِنَّهُ تَرَكَ شَهْوَتَهُ وَتَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ مِنْ أَجْلِ. This really gets into the heart of the religious quest. No, we are servants of Allah. And so what does the servant do? The servant does what the master instructs the servant to do. A dutiful servant does what their master instructs them to do. To make it more contemporary, a dutiful employee does what their employer enjoins upon them to do. If your employer says, a lot of IT people, I need you to write code for A, you don't go and write code for B and then turn it into the boss. If you do, you're not going to get paid. You're not going to get your ajr. If you're dutiful, you write exactly what's been prescripted. So we are servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do what Allah enjoins upon us. We don't make it up ourselves and then call ourselves servants. Now, I don't think I should have to dress like this. I don't think I should have to spend for my wife. She makes more money than I do. So I don't think I have to obey the Quranic injunction that I'm responsible for her upkeep. Now, I don't think that I have to dress like this. You know, if Lil Wayne can wear skinny jeans, why can't I wear skinny jeans? You know, forget this Islamic codes of modesty. What kind of servant is that? What happens, we forget the fact that we're servants. We're ibar rahman, the servants of the merciful. The highest station for a human being is servitude. Therefore, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most honorific title he was given was Abdullah. Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa. Glorified is the one who's taken his servant, his slave servant, by night. Alhamdulillah, alladhi anzala ala. So this great station of the night journey, where the Prophet ﷺ is honored in ways no human being has been honored, he's mentioned in the context of his servitude. Allah Ta'ala says, Subhanalladhi asra bi nabiyihi, asra bi rasulihi, asra bi Muhammadin, asra bi abdihi. Alhamdulillah, alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab. All praise is due to Allah who has revealed the scripture unto his servant. Not his Rasul, not his Nabi, not his Habib, not his beloved, upon his servant. So in this great station, the maqam of being the last human being in human history to receive revelation, the Prophet is honored by his servitude, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because to the extent that we actualize our ubudiyah, our servitude, then we actualize the rububiyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the lordship of Allah. And to the extent that we magnify our imagined rububiyah, our lordship, we control our affair, we're the captain of our ship, the master of our fate, as the slogan of modern individualism proclaims, then we minimize the rububiyyah of Allah. Not in reality, because no one can do that, but within our own limited minds and mentalities. So Ramadan is reminding us of our servitude. And this is our proper relationship with our Lord. And that we're leaving these things for His sake, not because they're bad. If Allah said, fast from alcohol, fast from pork, what kind of fast would that be? We don't engage in those things anyway. But He says, no, fast from your lawful drink, and from your lawful food, and from your lawful relations, for my sake, min ajli, so that you can internalize your servitude. This is a lesson of Ramadan. Don't let it escape, brothers and sisters. We are servants of Allah. We are servants of Allah. وللصائم فرحتان فرحة عند فطره وفرحة عند لقاء ربه. This brief phrase, again, it encompasses a very important lesson for us, and that our religion is Sharia, and so the rulings and ahkam of fasting are Sharia. And dutifully obeying the Sharia, the laws of the religion, has its reward and it has its delight. So dutifully fasting, adhering to all the rules, getting up early, having suhoor, making the niyyah, fasting the entire day, hastening to break the fast after ascertaining the sun is going down. Don't go by your iPhone or your Galaxy, because if you see sunset on there, what is it? It's a moon, it's a half orb on the line. That's their sunset. Sunset is not until the horizon has completely enveloped the sun. The sun is below the horizon. Not that. So wait two or three minutes after your phone says sunset. But after you're certain, look at the sky. Maybe the machine stopped. As Ian Forrester mentions, the machine stops. The computer went haywire and your clock isn't working anymore. Go look, make sure it's starting to get a little dark. You see the twilight. And then hasten to break the fast. Once you're sure, hasten to break the fast. So you've obeyed the rules. And so when you break your fast, you have a great joy. It's a physical joy. And that's one of the fruits of obedience to our Lord. We weren't created to be wild men. We weren't created to be anarchists or wild women. We have some of those too. We were created to obey our Lord. Not to be wild people running here and fro, doing whatever we want. What kind of society can be built on anarchy? Anarchists never even thought about it. Their whole program is destroy authority. The authority of God, the authority of men. Right? We have to get rid of patriarchy. Patriarchy built the modern world. That's a fact. Now, should we have some equality? Should we have respect for all the genders? Absolutely. But if we do away with the foundation of the modern world, what's left in its place? As we said last week, it's not matriarchy, it's anarchy. And what are you going to build on the foundation of anarchy? Let's get rid of the family. What happens to our children? What happens to our true future? Let's get rid of male authority. Let's get rid of female authority for that matter. Let's get rid of all authority. Let's get rid of governmental authority. That's the anarchist. But where in the anarchist program does it tell us what do we replace it with? What do we build with it? What do we erect in its place? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. So we're saying no, we accept the authority of God. We accept the authority within our families. And people say, yeah, that's just you're reinforcing the patriarchy you just bragged about. You don't know the family, the Muslim family. Who's the head of them? Every Muslim family has a matriarch. The grandmother. Who's more rightful and fitting to your obedience? Min abaru, ya Rasulallah. Ummuka. He said it three times. Your mother is more fitting for your obedience. Thumma man. Then your father. There's a balance in society. We can't look at the surface of things and then make hasty judgments based on the superficial manifestations of things to fit someone's ideological agenda. What Muslim man does not dutifully obey his mother? How many Muslim men in this congregation wanted to get job A and their mother said no, get job B and they took B? How many wanted to marry sister A and their mother said no, you marry sister B? Now they're happily married to B. Use it. But how many openly rebelled against their mother? There's a balance in our societies. And our religion wants us to respect that balance. Because the alternative is imbalance. The alternative is lack of balance. We want to have equilibrium. A balance between men and women. And a beautiful harmony. And not these disjointed, imbalanced realities that we're facing today. Balances in our homes, balances in our society, balances within our lives. So we have the Sharia, but we have the Hakika. وَفَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ لِقَاءِ رَبِّهِ. None of that, and the delight when he or she meets their Lord. So that has nothing to do with the law. That has something to do with a metaphysical, transphysical reality, an otherworldly reality. But it's just as real as this, it's more real than this physical reality. And so we have a balance between both. We have a balance in society, we have a balance within ourselves, we have a balance within the structure of the universe. And so Ramadan is encouraging us to respect that balance. And the foul odor that emanates from the mouth of the fasting person, sometimes, not everyone, some people, sometimes, not everyone, all the time, is sweeter to Allah than the fragrance of musk. And when the stomach is empty, and depending on what you might have had for a meal, there's gases and they can come up, and it's sometimes not pleasant smell. But it is something that is a consequence of obeying our Lord. And because it's a consequence of obeying our Lord, it might smell bad with the people, but it's sweeter with Allah than the fragrance of musk. Because it's something that's a consequence of His obedience. So if things that we do that constitute obeying Allah, the people don't like, but Allah loves it, you should love it, brothers and sisters. If Allah loves you to dress modestly and the people don't like it, no, you need to take some clothes off. You must be hot. See, well, you must be hot looking at me because you're doing all the complaining. If Allah loves it and it involves a little discomfort, then you should love it knowing Allah loves it. And you should love it because it's pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa ridwanullahi akbar. The pleasure of Allah is greater. So this is our religion. And Ramadan is trying to reinforce and enforce and encourage these lessons. May we incorporate them, may we internalize them. There's a lot to be said, but as you said, we ran out of time. Barakallahu feekum, wa yataqabbal minkum, wa sallallahu ala sayyidi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Another manifestation of taqwa very quickly, or another context is mentioned. So taqwa is mentioned in the context of fasting. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Taqwa was also mentioned in the context of our race relations. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. Oh, humanity, humankind, all of you Muslims, non-Muslims, whoever you might be, verily we've made you, created you from a single pair. We all have the same parentage. That's been genetically proven. We all have the same parents. Ultimately, our great-great to whatever the power of grandparents, Adam and Eve, we all come from that single pair. إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارُفُوا. And we made you into nations and tribes that you know one another. Not that you hate one another. Look at the tribalism. We see our country, to say nothing of our world, sinking into. People fortifying themselves into their different tribes, the black tribe, the white tribe, the brown tribe, the red tribe, the democratic tribe, the republican tribe, the liberal tribe, the conservative tribe, and engaging in tribal warfare. Allah said, no, I didn't make you into tribes that you may fight each other, despise each other, and hate each other, and undermine each other, and oppress each other, and suppress each other's rights, and deny each other, and steal from each other, and usurp each other's resources. لِتَعَارَفُوا. I made you into nations and tribes so that you can see in all that diversity the power of my creative ability to bring from that single pair all of this diversity. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honored of you with God is the one who has the most consciousness and awareness of God, the most eager to obey His orders and prohibition. Honor transcends race. There's no virtue in being white. There's no virtue in being black. There's no virtue in being a European or an African or an Asian or a Native American or anything. The only virtue for a human being is their God consciousness. And when we can get to that point, we can get beyond all of this hatred and tension and hardship and division and war and conflict and killing and murder that we see happening in our world. We have to get beyond it, brothers and sisters. And God is reminding us, Allah Ta'ala, our Creator, is reminding us we won't get beyond it without Him, without His help, and turning to Him. ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادِ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ عَيْدِ النَّاسِ لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْدَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Corruption has appeared in the land and the sea. And it's not just the physical corruption, the pollution of the air and the water and the land and the Superfund cleanup sites. We can't even say EPA Superfund cleanup sites. They're dedicated to creating more of them now. It's not just the physical pollution, it's the mental and spiritual pollution that leads to the racism and leads to the wars and the conflicts and the usurpation and the oppression and the tyranny. And so our Creator says, He gives us a taste of what our hands have brought about. لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْدِ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. That perhaps they will return back to the path of divine guidance. So this is our challenge, to turn back ourselves to the path of divine guidance, and to encourage our brothers and sisters in humanity to turn back to the path of divine guidance, which means humbling ourselves and not assuming that we have all the answers. That hasn't worked out too well, has it? May Allah Ta'ala give us tawfiq. Allahumma awfiq al-muslimin wal-muslimat wal-mu'minin wal-mu'minat al-ahya'i minhum wal-amwat. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahmah innaka antal wahhab. Rabbana afrigh 'alayna sabran wa thabbit aqdamana wa ansurna 'ala al-qawmi al-kafirin. Rabbana afrigh 'alayna sabran wa thabbit aqdamana wa tuwaffina muslimin wa'fu 'anna waghfir lana warhamna أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الهم والحزن، ونعوذ بك من العجز والكسل، ونعوذ بك من الجبن والبخل، ونعوذ بك من قهر الدين وكفر الرجال. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تعول به بيننا وبين معصيك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا بها جنتك، ومن اليقين ما يهون علينا مصائب الدنيا، ومتعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرا على من ظلمنا، وانصرنا على من عدانا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا يا أرحم الراحمين. واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا، أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. أقم الصلاة يرحم الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.